الله أكبر احتموه.
Jets overhead, the world watched in shock as a military coup unfolded in Turkey, a NATO country and ally of the West. The army attempted to put Turkey's main cities into lockdown, taking over state television and instructing a newsreader to announce a peace council was now in charge. Turkey's increasingly authoritarian president appeared to have lost control, but not for long.
Every day at the moment, 6 people don't make it. Almost 3,000 have drowned this year. But the total arrival figures are just astounding. Now some 500,000 and more, as we know, are coming.
We're standing here in the forest close to the refugee asylum of Amersfoort. We want to interview a representative and ask him some questions about what can be done to support or help the refugees. We couldn't interview him because of the coronavirus. We also wanted to film the building, but because of privacy laws, we weren't allowed to film there.
This is a picture of the building of the AZC. As you can see on the picture, this picture was taken from the street. We took this picture from the site of Wikimapia. This picture was made from a bird's eye view angle. This picture gives a bit of an idea of how big the building and the surroundings are of the refugee asylum in Amersfoort. This picture is from the site of the AZC itself.
A lot of refugees find it frightening to share the story of why they have fled their home country. We have interviewed someone who is willing to share a story but wants to stay anonymous, meaning that he doesn't want to be on camera or on audio. So we will share his story instead.
He is a political refugee from Turkey. He has fled for the political regime. They blamed him for being a terrorist, like a lot of people there. Namely, after the Turkish military coup in 2016, many people were arrested. According to him, it was nothing more than a political game. High educated people were wrongly imprisoned in inhumane captivity. Some people even died. He also stated that it still happens and that more than 1,000 babies are imprisoned. Scared for imprisonment, he fled. He knows other people that had the same problem as he had. Some could migrate to other countries, but a lot got arrested. The journey he had been through to reach the Netherlands was difficult for him. he passed the river Efros with a boat across the border of Turkey and Greece. There were 5 babies and 10 adults on board. He found it a demoralizing experience to see normal adults and children fleeing from their home country. When he got to Greece, he went by plane to the Netherlands. When he got to Schiphol Airport, he finally felt safe. At Schiphol Airport, he was transported to the refugee camp in Ter Apel. He told us that at first he felt confused about what's in store for him. He didn't know where he was, and in the first few days he had some doubts about all what was going on. But after a few days getting used to the environment, he had more trust that it was going to be okay. His stay in Ter Apel lasted for 6 months. Now he is busy learning the language and his part-time job. We also asked him about how the refugees are perceived in the Netherlands. He found it a very important question, so we got a broad answer. Namely, a lot of highly educated people come to the Netherlands to seek refuge. These highly educated people have experience in good social economic conditions. In the Netherlands, he finds that these people are not well utilized, as they want to be useful for their families and the Dutch society. He gave an example that there are now doctors and nurses that reside in asylum seeker centers or are workless that could help with the battle against the coronavirus. He doesn't find it logical that people with 20 years of work experience are not allowed to work professionally. According to his experience, they are treated like people who've led an uneducated life of poverty in a land of war. The problem is that their degrees are not recognized. He's therefore in favor of the solution of guidance programs with education and integration aid. If this happens, it will have a major positive effect not only for the economy of the Netherlands but also for society.
He finds the Dutch language difficult to learn. Also, he finds that the Dutch government pay too little attention to help him learn the language and to find a job. But he is grateful for the people that helped him during his integration, and he now feels safe in the Netherlands.
What are the roles of the Netherlands, Greece and Poland within the refugee crisis?
People are fed up with it. People are fed up with politicians who allow them all to come and who are not dealing with the security of our own citizens.
Grants asylum to people who would be in danger if they were to return to their own country. In the Netherlands, there are special international treaties on the protection of refugees. These are two examples of certain protection conventions. The first one, the Geneva Convention on Refugees. This one states that every refugee has a right to protection. At the Refugee Convention in 1951, they made a rule that a refugee should not be returned to a country where they face serious threats to their life or freedom. The second one. The European Convention on Human Rights states that no one may be subjected to torture, to inhuman, degrading treatment or punishment. The European Convention on Human Rights is the first council of Europe's convention and is the basis of all its activities. It was accepted in 1950 and started in 1953. Start of the asylum procedure. Depending on the available reception capacity the asylum seeker is placed in, an asylum seeker center. This is a regular reception center. An emergency reception. This is a temporary reception in the event of a shortage in asylum seeker centers. For example, in multi-purpose halls or holiday parks. A crisis reception. This is a reception of a very temporary nature, for a maximum of 72 hours. For example, a reception in sports centers. Application is granted. Asylum seekers receive a temporary residence permit. Housing in the government. Permanent or temporary accommodation is possible. For example, through regular accommodation in the rented sector, additional accommodation in refurbished empty buildings. For this, the government's authorities can make use of special schemes. A temporary permit has been revoked, for example, because protection is no longer needed. Request was rejected. Return voluntary or forced. To determine if refugees need protection, they must follow an asylum procedure. When the refugees come into the Netherlands, they first must report to the YND, the Immigration and Naturalization Service at Ter Apel. The YND assesses all residents' applications of people who wish to live in the Netherlands or who want to become a Dutch citizen. After identification and registration, refugees are transferred to a reception center. Asylum seekers entering the Netherlands by plane can report to the Royal Netherlands Marechaussee at Schiphol Airport. As a rule, they are denied entry to the Netherlands. This means that they can't come to the Netherlands as civilians or tourists. The refugees remain in the application center at Schiphol Airport for the duration of this process. Time and rest. Asylum seekers are given at least 6 days to recover from their journey. The asylum procedure does not begin until after this period. During the rest and preparation period, they are given some information about the asylum procedure. They get help from a lawyer and a medical declaration for use during their asylum procedure. A second interview. This is a special interview so that the refugee can explain what he or she experienced in their country of origin and why they left. The YND will arrange a translator for this interview. The asylum seeker will call the assistance of a lawyer or a representative of the Dutch Refugee Council. The interview is made in a way that allows the refugee to speak freely, but also lets the YND ask critical questions if necessary. Afterwards, the asylum seeker sent a report of the interview. Together with their lawyer, they may send the YND corrections or additional information. YND assesses asylum applications on the basis of the asylum seeker's account, the security situation in the asylum seeker's country of origin. If the YND establishes that an asylum seeker needs protection, they will be given an asylum residence permit. Asylum seekers who do not require protection must return to their country of origin. Asylum seekers whose application is denied may apply to the district court for review of the YND's decision. They are often allowed to remain in the Netherlands while their case is being considered. If an asylum seeker comes from a country on the list of safe countries of origin, or already gets protection in a European member state, the application can be declared simply unfounded in a faster asylum procedure. In such cases, the asylum seeker is not given time for rest and preparation and is interviewed immediately. At this interview, the asylum seeker can explain why they would not be safe in their country of origin, but their arguments must be more convincing than for asylum seekers from countries that are not on the list. The interview usually takes place without a lawyer present. After the interview, the asylum seeker is allowed to consult a lawyer and send the YND additions or corrections to the report. If the application is declared manifestly unfounded or unacceptable, the asylum seeker must leave the Netherlands immediately. Children who have lived in the Netherlands for longer than 5 years without an authorized place to stay may be eligible for the scheme for long-term resident children under the age of 19, also known in Dutch as the Children's Amnesty Scheme. This Dutch government scheme enables young people to stay in the Netherlands as long as they follow certain rules. Asylum seekers deal with various organizations during the asylum procedure. For example, the Immigration and Naturalization Service, YND, processes the asylum application. The Dutch Council for Refugees provides information about the asylum procedure, among other things. The Netherlands has a lot of organizations that help the refugees in the Netherlands, but also in other European countries. For example, the Dutch Council for Refugees supports organizations in other countries. They have a whole program about what they do and want to change. Their main goal is to empower local organizations, improving the situation for refugees and asylum seekers in and around Europe. They support a number of local organizations to improve their capacity. They are currently working with local organizations in Greece, the Western Balkans, Curaçao and Hungary. They are empowering and strengthening local organizations through training, knowledge exchange and co-financing of projects. These are some results they have done with helping the refugees and supporting local organizations. There are many more organizations that support the refugees around Europe. This is a list of all the organizations from the Netherlands that help and support refugees in Europe. These are all organizations that are not from the government. The government supports refugees by trying to keep them safe in our country. But at the same time, they are trying to get rid of the refugees. Refugees that are in danger because of their country of origin can stay in the Netherlands. Other refugees need to return unless they have a really good reason on why they must stay. According to the International Rescue Committee, Greece has been viewed as an entry point for people seeking asylum. More than 50,000 refugees in Greece can no longer legally travel deeper into Europe. Most will likely remain in the country. Integration is the key to ensure that they build successful lives in their new home. This is a challenging task in any country, but especially in Greece, because of its financial difficulties. The European Union recently adopted border restrictions that have prevented refugees from entering Europe, putting the most vulnerable increasingly at risk. The European Union's policies also meant that Greece, along with Italy, is being asked to shoulder much of the responsibility for the lives of those who have reached Europe in search of safety. For instance, since the March 2060 agreement restricting border crossings, 60,000 refugees remain stuck on the Greek island of Lesbos, Chios, Kos, Samos, and Leros. Many are forced to live in overcrowded and dangerous conditions as they wait months for their asylum cases to be heard. An additional 38,000 refugees are living on the Greek mainland, the majority in urban settings. Most have been traumatized by war and require psychological help, medical aid and other humanitarian assistance. Greece cannot be expected to bear this responsibility on its own. Most refugees living in urban settings are unable to find work to support their families, as Greece continues to struggle economically in the aftermath of the 2015 financial crisis. High unemployment rates have taken a toll on the local population as well. The overall unemployment rate is above 20%. A robust integration program is needed to ensure that local residents, as well as asylum seekers, benefit from assistance. A lot of women are traveling alone with children. They need protection against sexual violence and trafficking. Children need support to heal from their trauma. A lot of unaccompanied children are waiting to reunite with their families relocated to other countries in Europe. A lot of these children fall victim to exploitation. On the 27th of February, Turkey announced that it would no longer stop refugees from trying to cross its borders into Europe, which have been closed since 2016. Greece has responded with a package of inhuman measures that violate European Union and international law. Security forces have been firing tear gas and repelling boats trying to reach Greece's shores. The government has also temporarily suspended the registration of asylum claims and said it will deport anyone who enters irregularly without examining their cases. This is a violation of Greece's responsibilities under the 1951 Geneva Convention on Refugees. The Greece government has made some inhuman choices within the refugee problem. They have sent back a lot of refugees into the ocean. According to Al Jazeera, refugees have been pushed back and mistreated. Shortly after they reached the Greek island of Lesbos, a group of Afghan refugees and migrants say that Greek authorities rounded them up, mistreated them, shoved them into life rafts and abandoned them at sea. According to The Guardian, a new asylum law was introduced last October. This has made it impossible to keep up with procedures unless someone has constant legal aid. This is a very limited service offered by only a few organizations. The government is also planning to make space to establish massive detention centers on the island, where asylum seekers could be restricted for long periods of time, in order to enable far more deportations. In addition to this, the government keeps announcing unrealistic plans, such as the creation of a floating barrier in the Aegean Sea, to keep the refugees away from crossing the border of Turkey to Greece. This will be like a wall floating on the water, but as we could see in America, a wall will not stop the migrants from crossing the border. As the refugee crisis continues, a lot of problems increasingly occur. For example, the fires in Moria. The fires have destroyed Greece's largest migrant camp, an overcrowded facility on the island of Lesbos, leaving nearly 13,000 people without shelter. The situation in Greece was already unsustainable. It is hard to imagine what this will do with the people that were already at breaking point.
What would you do in this situation?
To ensure that there will be no more cases like Moria, the European Union as a whole must reconsider its fundamental values. But Greece cannot wait for an agreement to fulfill the duties it already has to protect those seeking safety. This means they need to end illegal pushbacks and other abuses at the country's border, and ensuring access to fair asylum procedures. A lot of abuses that are taking place are denied by the Greek government and they are failing to investigate these accusations. The Greek government is not able to provide refuge. First, the economic crisis must be fixed before the government can provide asylum to the refugees. The government has made special camps for asylum seekers and tries to support them. There are just too many refugees and there's too little space. The camps are overwhelmed. The refugees live with the most basic conditions in the camps. Some of them don't even have shelter. That's why a lot of organizations are helping the refugees in Greece.
Such as the International Rescue Committee, that supports the refugees in Greece in multiple ways. They are focused in Greece on livelihood programming to support integration, and they are working with local partners to implement self-employment and employment readiness. The IRC also provides refugees in Greece with up-to-date information about available services, legal rights, options for asylum, relocation and family reunification. The IRC has created safe zones for unaccompanied and separated children in two refugee camps on the Greek mainland. These safe zones provide children with a safe alternative to police detention until they are reunified with family or placed in shelters or foster care. They also provide a variety of support services to vulnerable children in three other camps. Additionally, is the IRC collaborating with Greece's Ministry of Migration Policy and international humanitarian organization to address violence against women and girls, together with the psychological needs of all refugees and asylum seekers. These services are provided in multiple camps across the country. The IRC is also responding to the mental health needs of asylum seekers in overcrowded reception centers on the islands of Lesbos and Chios. The IRC provides much needed water sanitation and hygiene at the refugee sites in Greece. They provide access to drinking water, toilets, hot showers, laundry facilities and supplies like soap, shampoo and toothpaste. They also teach basic hygiene techniques that help prevent the spread of disease. And they also ensure that trash and recyclable items are collected. As more and more refugees are transferred from camps to apartments in towns and cities, the IRC is adapting a response to meet their basic needs. Protect them from exploitation and violence and assist them to build a better future for their families. The majority of the refugees in Greece will likely settle in the country. That's why the IRC will continue to work with local partners to ensure that refugees are integrated into their new communities. Shower Power is also an example of a non-governmental organization that supports the refugees in Greece. Shower Power supports the refugees in Greece by setting up bathrooms and showers so that the refugees can clean themselves and feel for a certain moment human again. They are collecting money from donations to ensure that the refugees can clean themselves and have sanitation.
Do you support the refugees? And how do you support them?
On Upfront, you're an MP and an MEP elect for Poland's Law and Justice Party, which was recently re-elected to government and which is often criticized for being anti-immigrant, anti-refugee. But actually, you're not anti-immigrant or anti-refugee. You're okay with white Christian immigrants from Ukraine. You've taken around 2 million of them in. You're just not okay, it seems, with brown Muslim refugees from the Middle East. White people fine, brown people not fine. There's a word for that, isn't there, Dominic?
Good evening. Thank you for having me. It has nothing to do with your color. It has nothing to do with the religion. I keep repeating it for last 4 or 5 years. It's all about safety and the common sense. It's not law. It's not about Ukrainians who are allowed to come to Poland. It's about illegal migrants who wants to cross our borders. And if you're brown, white, yellow, or whatever, if you want to cross our border illegally, you're not allowed. We are reacting.
Well, first of all, plenty of people are coming into Europe legally as asylum seekers. You have a legal right to asylum from places like Syria. But you say it's not about religion. You said, quote, we will not receive even one Muslim because this is what we promised. You didn't say illegal immigrants. You said we will not receive even one Muslim.
It has nothing to do with the Muslim religion. It's not Islamophobia, as someone's trying to tell us. It's all about this moment and this fact that at 2015 Angela Merkel started this madness, and now this is a problem about Muslims mainly coming to Europe. I'm surprised they are not going to Saudi Arabia, Qatar, or any other rich Muslim countries. They would feel much better, isn't that?
Seeking asylum is a fundamental human right, safeguarded by both the EU and the international refugee law. But why does Poland refuse to take part? The anti-refugee culture has nothing to do with the history of the country, because historically it was home to many diverse ethnicities. Now, Poland is one of the most religious countries in Europe, with 90% of the population that declares themselves Catholic. Muslim minorities have lived in Poland for centuries. Throughout this time, there has not been any hate against the Muslim community. Around 2010, that changed since the start of terrorist attacks and deaths of Polish soldiers during the Western invasion of Iraq and Afghanistan. This led to the vandalizing of mosques and the start of discrimination, which includes physical and verbal attacks. These tensions were fueled by the refugee crisis and eventually led to mass demonstrations against the ethnic and religious outsiders. The media also plays a big role in Poland's anti-refugee attitude, as they depict Muslim refugees as bad people and as invaders. This causes Islamophobia, but then without Muslims. This means that the population has negative attitudes to the group despite there being almost no Muslim presence in the country. There are only 35,000 Muslims in Poland, in a country of 48 million. That is less than 0.1% of the population. However, Poland is not only anti-refugee, but there's also a pro-refugee group that supports the refugees. This group includes anti-racists, feminists, refugees themselves, and LGBTQ groups. This pro-refugee group works against the government, more than supporting the refugees abroad. Their support is via public awareness, in the hope that the ideologies of Poland change to a more refugee-friendly way. Examples of these actions are letting non-Muslims learn about Islam and its followers by inviting them to mosques. More initiatives are going out during anti-refugee protests supporting peace and love. But still, there are too few that challenge what is already a dominant ideology in the country. Because of this, there is overall very little support for the refugees coming from Poland. Considering Poland's little support for the refugees, it has some exceptions on who they want to accept as refugee in their country, as they do show welcomeness for Christian refugees that are persecuted in their own country. Poland itself is namely a Christian country, and they would gladly open their borders for people of their own faith.
When refugees flee, they bring positive and negative effects with them. These effects fit mostly in the economical dimension. The effect of refugees can be negative or beneficial for both parties. Both parties being the host country and the refugees themselves. The positive effects for the refugees is obviously that they are saved from uncertainty and danger in their lives. For the host country, it is that refugees can start a productive life that will benefit society. The effects of refugees on jobs is not as negative as most people think. It may even be the opposite. Most migration economists agree that more refugee laborers don't affect the labor force for the natives. This is because often natives and foreigners mainly have different sets of skills and compete for different types of jobs. On top of that, the refugees that start their own business and create more job opportunities. Nevertheless, it does change the fact that refugees face underemployment. They are employed in job sectors you can access without any special qualification, as their qualifications aren't recognized. This has both a negative and a positive effect. The positive effect is that there are jobs for everyone and there is a workforce in all job sectors. The negative effect is that discrimination is at play and that the refugees are not well utilized within the country. Furthermore, the positive effect for the host country is that refugees can play an important role in international trade, since they know their country's origins and business environment. They can invest and boost both countries' local economies at the same time. It will not only be an economical boost for the country of origin, but also a boost in their technology and knowledge. The countries of origin will also benefit from money flows refugees will send if they have any family left in their home country they fled from.
The problem with refugees is the number. When 1 million people are seeking refuge, the drain on the country's economy is massive. Every aspect of someone's life has to be provided for. The list is extensive. Shelter, warmth, security, food, cooking facilities, clothing, medical support, education, emotional support and social care. Even if the money is available, having the infrastructure to receive and handle such a large amount of people is a challenge. It requires skilled people from every trade and profession to even begin to tackle the problem. This is why support often falls on charity organizations and volunteers. Another negative effect is that there will be a chance of an increase of criminality and violence. If a refugee had prior exposure to violence, it will likely be the same in the future. Also, because of the possible poverty that refugees will face, if they are not well integrated, they will likely engage in criminal activity. Deforestation is also a recurring theme in areas surrounding refugee camps, because refugees need firewood and wood to sometimes build shelter. Refugees also have a negative effect caused by environmental deterioration. Because of the environmental situations in refugee camps, clean water isn't widely available. Low quality water affects the health of a large number of people in a situation where there's a high risk of infectious diseases that are multiplying rapidly. Host countries notice this environmental deterioration too. Normally available materials and supplies for construction, consumption and fuel are short, and prices for fuel and food in local markets rise. As a result, tensions can rise as they are forced to bear all these costs without compensation.
The Netherlands, Greece and Poland have all different roles to support the refugees. For the Netherlands, they are overall welcoming towards the refugees and grant them asylum for those who came from dangerous countries. Their reintegration process is all for the purpose to help the refugee build a new and productive life. But the support that the government gives to provide them with a job and to learn the Dutch language is not enough. They also have the funds to host these refugees. Although they help the refugees which can't return because of the situation in their home country, they do send back refugees which don't have a good enough reason to stay. Furthermore, the Netherlands also have non-governmental organizations that support the refugees, such as the Dutch Council for Refugees that empower local organizations to improve the life of refugees over the whole of Europe. Greece's support for the refugees is minimalistic in comparison to the large number of refugees that have come to Greece to seek refuge. This is because of their financial instability. It cannot support the refugees efficiently. Together with all the unrealistic plans of the Greek government, they cause even more problems for the refugees. Examples of these problems are the overcrowded refugee camps and insufficient integration plans. The support that they do give is mostly from non-governmental organizations, like the International Rescue Committee or Shower Power. As for Poland, support is practically non-existing. The government only accepts refugees which supports the same Catholic faith. Only a small number of Polish citizens actually support the refugees. This pro-refugee group supports the refugees through spreading awareness in the hope that the Polish ideologies will change towards a more accepting view for the refugees. Polish citizens mainly think that foreigners who want to seek refuge are invading their country. Discrimination and anti-refugee ideology are thereby prominent. As for what can be done to help the refugees, is donating to organizations that support them. Humanitarian support and political support. These organizations will also efficiently help governments to help the pressure against the refugee streams. Sadly, this does not mean the end of the refugee crisis, as the roots of the problem lay within the country of origin. The question is, will it ever end?